Good evening, everybody. Today also we are coming with a nice CME from Chess Council of India. Today's evening is about discussion on histopathology and the most important part in the diagnosis of very important diagnosis we come across in pulmonary diseases. I am Dr. Nazia Naushin. I am moderating today's session. I'm a pulmonologist from Hyderabad. I would like to share my screen. The histopathological approach in pulmonary practice, the final ray of hope in complex pulmonary cases. We have speakers of today. I would like to introduce the speakers of today, Dr. Ranjani Chakravarti from Hyderabad, Dr. Chandralekha Thampi from Mumbai, and Dr. Shilpi Doshi from Indore. Dr. Ranjani Chakravarti, she did her MBBS and Masters in Pathology from Gandhi Medical College, and she has also done her FRCS in Pathology in UK. She is working presently as Managing Director in CPath Labs, Hyderabad. She has numerous papers and in international journals, and she's also a member of Royal College of Pathologists in UK. Dr. Shilpi Doshi, she has done her MBBS from BRD Medical College, Gorakhpur, and Pathology from MLB Medical College, Jhansi. Her designation is Professor in SAIMS Medical College, Indore. She has 10 years of experience, and her areas of interest are lung pathology, bronchial cytology, lung biopsy, EBUS TBNA, pleural fluid cell block study, and IHCs in lung malignancies. She has done pulmonary pathology course organized by Mayo Clinics in USA. And she has 10 to 12 publications in national and international journals. Dr. Chandralekha Thampi, she is a student of AFMC Pune. She is presently HOD Histopathology in Leelavati Hospital, Mumbai. Her areas of interest are lung and GI pathology, and she has multiple publications and presentations. I would like to hand over to Dr. Ranjani Chakravarti to start her session. Thank you, madam.
A very good evening to all. My today's talk is on EBUS and ROSE. I know that the predominant audience will be pulmonologists, so I shall confine myself today to the pathology aspects of these techniques. Also, in view of time constraints, the presentation itself is necessarily brief, but I'm sure we can catch up during the Q&A session. On today's agenda, we will be briefly talking about what EBUS, TBNA and ROSE represent, what are the indications for these procedures, what are the techniques involved, how is the cytological examination performed, and what ancillary studies can then be performed on this material. So what is EBUS, TBNA? This is basically endoscopic ultrasound guided transbronchial needle aspiration. This is a minimally invasive technique which allows for sampling of mediastinal lymph nodes or lung lesions, principally by fine needle aspiration and under direct sonographic visualization. What are the advantages of this procedure? Like I said, this is minimally invasive, allows for real-time image guidance. It allows for tissue diagnosis on abnormal PET-CT findings. It has blood sampling capabilities. And also, more importantly, it allows for ROSE, a rapid on-site evaluation and diagnosis. It is more economical than, say, an open biopsy or even mediastinoscopy. It is much safer than that procedure as well. It can be used in candidates who are poor surgical candidates or those who have non-surgical disease, and yields good samples that permit ancillary studies. So what are the disadvantages of EBUS? We cannot assess all lymph nodes. This technique is not universally available. It is in India, particularly, it's only available in the higher centers and in tertiary referral centers. If ROSE is required, then a lot of time is needed to do the procedure. Both ROSE and EBUS require a lot of technical expertise. There is a possibility of non-diagnostic specimens, and after all the trouble of doing the process, and even after ROSE, we do occasionally get non-diagnostic specimens. There is a risk of needle contamination, and there is also a problem of a wide spectrum of diagnostic possibilities. The sensitivity and the specificity of this procedure are very high. Specificity is close to 100% in most studies, but its sensitivity varies on whether histology or clinical follow-up is used as the endpoint. So what is ROSE? ROSE stands for Rapid Onset Evaluation. Principally, this means that there is a pathologist and a technician available on site where the bronchoscopy is being performed. This principally allows for immediate staining of the material that has been aspirated during the technique, and also allows for microscopic evaluation of the same. So immediate feedback can be provided to the pulmonologist about both the qualitative and quantitative adequacy. So principally, it should improve diagnostic aid, and also it allows for triage. So if the provisional diagnosis is, for instance, a granulomatous inflammation, additional sampling can be done for microbiology or a molecular testing, or if we have a pure population of lymphocytes, then additional sample can be drawn for flow cytometry. So what are the indications for ROSE tDNA? Staging or restaging of non-small cell lung carcinoma, sampling of nodes, obtaining tissue for diagnosis on large central lung tumors, which are not accessible by routine bronchoscopy, for the workup of lymphadenopathy, mediastinal lymphadenopathy, typically for tuberculosis, sarcoidosis, lymphoma, metastatic disease, and also sampling of mediastinal masses, but usually superior and anterior mediastinal tumors only. To the right, you have the well-described ones, lymph node stations, which I'm sure all the audience here is certainly aware of. So what are the ancillary tests we can perform by this technique? We can perform immunocytochemistry, and we can also, which can be either diagnostic or it can be predictive. It allows for molecular testing, including predictive or prognostic testing. It allows for flow cytometry testing in case of possible lymphomas, and it also provides material for microbiological testing. Typically, in our hands, if it's granulomatous, we routinely recommend that a sample be sent for TB gene expert, allowing for drug resistance as well to be assessed, or for PCR or other molecular microbiological testing, including culture tests. So how do we, as pathologists, prepare for this procedure? The first step would obviously be to discuss the case with the clinician. I mean, this is good practice regardless of whether it is ROSE or any other form of FNA. We should certainly discuss the area of interest, the route to sampling, and the process of sampling. The pathologist should certainly be cognizant of all relevant imaging and the details of the clinical history. The pathologist should also know whether there's a strong clinical suspicion of malignancy, and they should be aware of the diagnostic pitfalls and risks. Has there been recent radiotherapy, contamination due to root of needle, other inflammatory changes? So what are the requirements in terms of consumables and equipment? Certainly a patient request form with all necessary information, protective equipment, and all the usual paraphernalia of an FNAC, slide boxes, cytolite solution, a rapid stain, Diffquick is what we typically use, or any other rapid stain. We even do rapid HP sometimes. We also need a vial rack, deionized water, and sample vials, a microscope, a pen and pencil. So typically 21, 22, or 25 gauge needles are used. However, the needle size is usually determined by the operator based on the location of the node, the vascularity, and the type of specimen processing. So what are next steps for the pathologist slash technician? Slides are labeled with the patient's details, the lesion node, and the pass number. Also, 10 ml of saline solution is placed into a vial labeled with appropriate details. And this vial is placed into a vial rack to prevent spillages. So what is the FNA technique itself? The first step, of course, to get the needle into the lesion, which is visualized via ultrasound. The stylet is moved in and out to dislodge any bronchial wall contaminant. The stylet is then removed. Vacuum is generated, that is, you pull back on the syringe and make excursions. That is, move the needle 2 to 3 movements per second, long amplitude movements. This is very important because just creating negative pressure by pulling back on the syringe without the appropriate needle movements is insufficient for tissue collection. The needle movement cuts the tissue, while the negative pressure exerted by pulling back on the syringe assists the tissue into the needle. Limit dwell time to no more than 5 or 10 seconds maximum. Release the vacuum and pull the needle out of the lesion. So what next? So then the sample is handed over to the pathologist. The whole sample is expelled into a vial lid using a stylet. The sample is mixed well. The technician then places a representative drop of the sample onto a glass slide, and a good spread is made. It is allowed to air dry, and then staining is performed, like I said earlier, either a diffquick or a quick MGG process, and then microscopic assessment by the pathologist as per pre-agreed adequacy criteria. The next step is actually to feed back to the clinician if the sample is actually adequate. I mean, have we got enough material? In that case, the needle is flushed with the saline into the vial that we had earlier prepared. The remaining sample is also transferred into the vial, and at the end of the procedure, from this vial, we make aliquots for ancillary testing as required for flow cytometry or microbiology. We also add a preservative to make sure that the sample viability is maintained. So what is the whole workflow? Principally, after an initial pass, if we feel that the sample is inadequate, then we usually ask the clinician to repeat the sample till we have sufficient volume for whatever tests that are required. If we feel it is diagnostic, then next comes an initial assessment of the pathology. If it's a benign diagnosis, for instance, if we see granulomas, then like I said earlier, we would recommend an additional sample to be drawn for molecular testing, including for gene expert testing and for TB-PCR or for other cultures as appropriate. If the sample looks malignant, then principally we need enough material for a cell block, which will then enable us to do AIHC. It will also allow us to do additional molecular testing, including EGFR, PD-L1, ALK. And if it's a lymphoma, then we would just submit the sample for flow cytometry. So the pathologist needs to very clearly delineate their reporting terminology so that the clinician and the pathologist are on the same page and the clinicians understand what the pathologist means. If the report is inadequate sampling, repeat sampling is to be done. If sampling is adequate, then the procedure can be stopped. If it's a diagnostic sampling, but more material is required for ancillary tests, then we ask for a repeat sample. If there is sufficient cell yield and the sample is diagnostic, then we would say stop procedure. So what are the advantages of ROSE? Allows preliminary information to be relayed in terms of adequacy and also preliminary diagnosis, which then allows specimen triage for ancillary studies. Potentially, there could be guidance on how to improve yield techniques, or we could feed back to the clinician on which site is perhaps more cellular, and that could guide additional sampling. And also, it allows for sampling to be stopped when diagnostic material is obtained, and there is no need to do a set number of passes. So what are the challenges of ROSE? One of the biggest challenges is that it needs a pathologist who's experienced with ROSE. It is very time consuming. A study suggests that the average amount of time per site sampled is about 12 to 22 minutes. Average pathologist adequacy assessment time was 38 minutes with a range of 2 to 142 minutes. There have been suggestions that maybe interventional pulmonologists or cytotechnologists could be trained for an initial evaluation. And this study has shown an over 90% concordance with the cytopathologist. However, this would only be the initial adequacy assessment and would not extend to the diagnostic work. Telecytology can also be used if there are no pathologists available on the ground. So once a sample is actually in the lab, how do we assess the sample? So typically, not just rows, any FNA sample, our principal concerns would be, is it adequate? Is it actually diagnostic? In the sense of, what are the percentage of cases that we can proffer an actual diagnosis? What is the sensitivity, specificity, PPV and the NPV? And what is the accuracy of the procedure in comparison with the gold standard? In this case, that would be an HND biopsy. So several adequacy criteria have been proposed for lymph node sampling in the mediastinum. One by Al-Sharif et al. Suggests the presence of 40 lymphocytes in a high power field in the most cellular area would be an adequate smear, or the presence of pigmented macrophages or diagnostic material. I mean, this could just be malignancy or it could be granulomas. So even if you didn't have the lymphocytes, this would still be considered adequate. Nayak et al. Have proposed a different set of criteria, and they suggest that there should at least be 5 low power fields, each containing 100 lymphocytes, and there should be 2 or more bronchial cell groups in a low power field. Alternately, the presence of germinal center fragments or diagnostic material would also render the specimen adequate. So a smear is predominantly hemorrhagic. There are no lymphocytes. So if the entire sample went like this, this would certainly be inadequate. And a repeat sample would be required. This is a 40x view, and it shows close to 40 lymphocytes. So this would be adequate. This shows a group of bronchial epithelial cells. These are other things that we commonly see during this process: a granulomatous inflammation, TB with a lot of caseous necrosis, sarcoid type granulomas. These smears are very similar and show large groups of viable abnormal cells. So this is just a small taste of the range of cytology that we do see during this process. Okay, so it all sounds very good, and you would think that this is an ideal procedure. It saves on time, and the diagnostic yield should be very good. It should be adequacy criteria should be all met with, and it should be very accurate. But as the Bard famously said, what's in a name? This is Rose, and it does have its thorns as well. So there have been controversies in the past about a few issues. Does Rose actually help with adequacy? So a study by Trisolini et al., which included 168 patients randomized to conventional TDNA with and without Rose. And as you can see here, the adequacy rate is higher for TDNA without Rose than TDNA with Rose. It's 86.5 in the without Rose category, and it is only 78.4% in the with Rose category. Similarly, with the diagnostic yield, there is only very marginal difference between TBNA with and without Rose. So this is another study which shows that the specificity, sensitivity, the PPV and the accuracy are all pretty similar for TBNA with and without Rose. The only does Rose have any advantages at all? Well, it certainly results in a reduction in the number of targeted sites, and also results in a reduction in the number of slides generated, thereby saving money and the cytologist's time. A very recent paper published in May 2021 actually suggests, in fact, that these days, you know, with lung cancers, a principal interest is in harvesting tissue for biomarker testing. And it shows that biomarker testing of CNB specimens has a significantly higher success rate than does biomarker testing of cytology FNA specimens, and that the adequacy of EBUS TDNA samples is not significantly different from that of transthoracic needle aspiration samples. This is a point for a discussion, and I'm sure we can take it up during the Q&A. So to summarize, EBUS TBNA is a minimally invasive technique where an FNA procedure can be performed under ultrasound guidance. If there is a pathologist on the ground, this allows for immediate assessment of adequacy. It also allows for the preliminary diagnosis, which then allows for additional ancillary testing in the form of molecular testing or microbiological testing. And the take-home messages, though ROSE has advantages, feedback to the endoscopist is instantaneous within 2 or 3 minutes, and we can give them adequacy and a professional diagnosis, allows for system management and triage for ancillary testing, and results in a reduction in the number of sites and passes. However, the disadvantages are that you need a trained pathologist, and there is also the fear of having insufficient material for the procedure. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to share the platform here with multiple pulmonologists. And I'm going to talk to you on the pathology of interstitial lung disease. Interstitial lung disease is a spectrum of diseases that have different causes, different therapies, different ways of prognosis, but they all have some amount of overlapping in the way they present and in their clinical features and in their radiology and histology. So they are quite challenging for clinicians and pathologists. As I said, they could be an interstitial lung disease could have reasons like the occupation the patient is having, allergens in his environment. It can be a lung manifestation of a systemic disease, or it can be idiopathic. And to come to a correct diagnosis is quite challenging. Now, everything that is seen in radiology in the HRCT has its reflection in pathology. So, for example, what they call linear would be this interstitium widening in this linear fashion that will show up as a shadow at the HRCT. What they call reticulonodular is usually linear shadows that are overlapping. Only very rarely will it have this real nodules, as say in sarcoidosis, lymphangitis, carcinomatosis, or silicosis. What we call ground glass is something that is always something we look forward to seeing in the HRCT report, because these are reversible changes and they are usually due to something within the alveolar lumina, either macrophages or some plugs, like in Mason's plugs, and these are usually the reversible changes. Now, the transbronchial biopsy is one that the pulmonologists are always most comfortable with giving us, but it has its limitations. But there are some places where it does have a role to play in interstitial lung disease. Now, this is a transbronchial biopsy. As you can see, this is the bronchial lining on the surface, and this is the subbronchial tissue. There are a few alveoli. You do not get much alveoli in a transbronchial biopsy. But if you look in this transbronchial biopsy, along with this anthracotic pigment, there's a space over here with some cells in the middle. On a higher power, you can see these atypical cells. They are within a space lined by endothelium. IHC with TTF1 has shown a TTF1 positivity. So this is adenocarcinoma of the lung. And this is what we are seeing is lymphangitis carcinomatosis. This can be detected in transbronchial biopsies. Similarly, if the patient has a suspicion of having hypersensitivity pneumonitis, if you get along with the fibrosis and mild inflammation, a giant cell like this with a cleft within it, then you can also offer a diagnosis that yes, pathologically, we do feel that this is hypersensitivity pneumonitis. But other than this, most other ILDs have very heterogeneous patterns, and it depends on where in the lobule the pathology is. Some of them are in the periphery of the secondary lobule, the inflammation changes, everything. And a forceps biopsy is not often sufficient to establish a diagnosis in these ILDs, as you will see in these cases that we see. Now, the best biopsy which a pathologist would really like to have is a VATS-assisted or a surgical lung biopsy, in which a good wedge of lung tissue is received, about 3.5 centimeters to 2 centimeters in breadth. And this wedge should be taken above the area of fibrosis, because the area of absolute fibrosis can show end-stage lung disease, and it does not tell you what is the pathology happening within the lung causing this end-stage fibrosis. So let's see a few cases. This is a 67-year-old man. His HRCT was indeterminate for UIP, and we received a VATS lung biopsy. Now, if you see, there is fibrosis in this lung. Compare it with this normal lung over here. And you can see the fibrosis is not the same everywhere. The fibrosis is more in the periphery and less towards the center of this lobule. So it is heterogeneous. This is what we call heterogeneous. And here again, you see there is a lot of fibrosis in this upper corner. And over here, the interstitium is almost normal. So heterogeneity is there. which would not have got picked up in a transbronchial. Now, this widened interstitium widened by fibrosis shows hardly any inflammatory cells. Inflammation is sparse. And in some areas, you see fresh fibroblastic formation forming. These are fibroblastic foci. Here, you see a fibroblastic foci. And these are usually at the junction of the fibrotic and the non-involved area of the lung. This is actually the pathology creeping through the lung like a forest fire. And there are areas where there is honeycombing and there is traction bronchiectasis. Here you see a large dilated, abnormally distended bronchus pulled towards the side of the lobule. And so therefore, this with all these features, that is a patchy involvement, heterogeneous involvement, peripheral zones of fibrosis, the central part being spared, fibroblastic foci, inflammation sparse, honeycombing and traction bronchiectasis, this patient has all the histological features of a UIP and therefore IPF. So now let us see another case. Similarly, again came with an HRCT that was not very classical of any of the subtypes. Again, you see there is heterogeneity in this lung biopsy, again a wedge biopsy. There is fibrosis at the periphery. The central area is spared. You see the central sparing and on the periphery there is large wide fibrosis. There's traction bronchiectasis. Here you see a bronchus that has been pulled right to the periphery of the lobule. And within these alveolar lumina, you see a lot of macrophages. Lots and clumps of alveolar macrophages. And there is honeycombing also. All the features of UIP, right? And the inflammation is also sparse. But if you look at the history, this is a young man. He's only 41. And he's been having these features indolently since a long time. This does not fit in with an IPF. You go back into the history and find out what is he doing? What is his history? Is there something that gives you a clue? And he's a builder. And he says he spends most of his days at the construction site inhaling dust. What he's having is occupational lung disease with a UIP pattern. It's a pneumoconiosis with a UIP pattern. So this gives you the importance of a multidisciplinary discussion, a detailed history of what patient's life is like. And this secondary UIP pattern can be due to many conditions, chronic hypersensitivity, asbestosis, collagen vascular disease, etc. So just seeing the pathology on its own does not help you. It has to be multidisciplinary. You have to get and take in the history of this patient very carefully. Now, this is a young girl. She has a desk job and she's increasingly breathless over 3 years along with significant weight loss. Now, if you look at her lung, again, there's heterogeneity. Some parts of the lung are fibrosed and inflamed and some parts are quite uninvolved. And if you look at where is this inflammation and fibrosis occurring, it's all peribronchiolar. You see this bronchiole? Everything is peribronchiolar and the lymphocytic infiltrate is so dense. There is so many lymphocytes in this lung. If you look again carefully, there are some areas that are showing you giant cells with clefts. And this is what clinches a diagnosis along with an ill-formed granuloma. What this child has, you go back to her history and yes, she tells you, yes, I live near a kabutar khana. I live near a pigeon cote. What she has is chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis and the characteristic features are the inflammation is bronchiolocentric. She's inhaling the problem. There's a rich lymphocytic infiltrate. There are ill-formed granulomas, giant cells with clefts. She was treated and her lungs almost cleared up. This shows you how the diagnosis matters and the prognosis will then match. This is a 41-year-old woman. She came with breathlessness, fever and cough. It was not clear on HRCT. These are the only ones that come to us where the HRCT is not clear. A VATS biopsy was done. As a surgeon was going in, he noticed this parts of the pleura were very thickened, very nodular, basket weaving collagen. And when you look at the lung, again, there's heterogeneity. Again, there is inflammation and fibrosis that is peribronchiolar. The other areas are spared. Heterogeneity is there, but it's reversed as a new, unlike the UIP. This is all centered around the bronchiole, something that she's breathing in. And here again, you see peribronchiolar. There's a lot of anthracotic pigment also. And when you put a nice thin section, you see there are some particles in this peribronchiolar inflammation. You do an iron stain. Iron encrusted particles, what are these? This is asbestosis. So peribronchiolar fibrosis, asbestos bodies, and she had these pleural plaques with basket weave collagen. What she was suffering from was asbestosis. Now, this is another 36-year-old lady who came with blood-tinged sputum, weakness and breathlessness. We received a wedge biopsy. You see over here, there is a lot, it's a very busy lung. There is a lot of things within the alveolar lumina and the interstitium is widened and there is quite a significant lymphocytic infiltrate. This is not heterogeneous. It's almost homogeneous, her pathology. And this is what is within her alveolar lumina. a lot of siderophages confirmed with an ion stain. These are siderophages within the alveolar lumina, and a rich lymphocytic infiltrate in a widened fibrosed interstitium. So we said this is an NSIP pattern, homogeneous fibrosis, inflammatory infiltrate, and she had acute pulmonary hemorrhage within the alveoli. There was no capillaritis. We suggested SLE, and sure enough, going back, the serology said that yes, she is having SLE. This was who had come primarily with a lung manifestation of SLE. Now, another young girl, she had been long ago treated for tuberculosis, but now she was becoming increasingly breathless, and her HRCT was suggestive of ILD. Again, you see the fibrosis is throughout the entire lobule of the lung in this VATS biopsy. You see the homogeneous collagen, all the interstitia are involved. But when you look at the inflammatory infiltrate as compared to the last one, there's hardly any inflammatory infiltrate. The fact that there's homogeneous fibrosis tells you that yes, this is probably all over fibrosis. It is a NSIP pattern, but there is sparse inflammation. This is a fibrotic subtype of NSIP. It's a young woman. Again, we suggested, is this a connective tissue disease? Her serology showed yes, she's having scleroderma. And scleroderma, the inflammatory infiltrate is sparse. Progressive systemic sclerosis with a lung manifestation. Now, this was an older lady, 58-year-old, who came with low-grade cough, mild breathlessness. She had had repeated antibiotics taken. She had not improved over the last 3 months, and her HRCT findings persisted. A VATS lung biopsy was done. What a busy lung. You see how much inflammation, there's fibrosis, everything seems to be happening in this lung. And you see this young fibroblastic proliferation that is pouring through the pores of Korn into the alveolar spaces. See this young fibroblastic proliferation, Mason's plugs filling the alveolar spaces, inflammation within the expanded interstitium. There's an expanded dilated bronchiole with a lot of neutrophils within it. She has some bronchiectasis also, for which she was having postural cough. See the neutrophils in that dilated bronchiole. So diffuse, her primary pathology here was a diffuse airspace organization, and this was cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. She was treated and she improved significantly. Cryptogenic, as there was no underlying cause. So in this spectrum of few cases that I have shown you, we have seen two UIPs, both of different causes. One was an occupational cause, the other was IPF. Then we saw dust in a builder, allergy in a hypersensitive girl to pigeon dust, connective tissue diseases, two of them within the lung, and a cryptogenic organizing pneumonia. And all of these, the diagnosis was possible because the biopsy was adequately big, and we could see all the features. There's a lot of overlapping in the histology, but it is when you put them all together, you weigh one against the other, that you receive a correct diagnosis. So in all interstitial lung disease, there is an interplay between fibrosis. Where is it located in the lobule? What is the age of this fibrosis? What is the amount of inflammatory cells? And all this is possible to be seen and evaluated only when the sample size is adequate, a surgical lung biopsy. The disadvantages are there, cost and morbidity, but at the cost of a correct diagnosis. Cryobiopsy is increasingly being advocated by many pulmonologists, but a cryobiopsy is nothing but an expanded transbronchial biopsy. The only area you're sampling is again peribronchiolar. It will not give you an entire lobule to study. And that are its disadvantages. If you're thinking of sarcoid, yes, you will have more tissue to study, but it will not give you enough to see the peripheral part, whether it's is it heterogeneous, are there fibroblastic foci, all this will not show up. And in addition, the cryobiopsy, because of the freezing, does introduce some artifact into the tissue, which makes your study of the collagen, etc., a little suboptimal. So this was a study in which over 600 ILD patients were studied. 55% of them had at least one misdiagnosis, 38% had two. Their median time to a correct diagnosis was over 7 months. Some of them were delayed for more than 3 years. They had had multiple tests done, and almost 50% of them had finally needed a surgical lung biopsy. So diagnosis of ILD requires a multidisciplinary team. Just HRCT alone is not very good. With the clinical, detailed clinical input, with discussion and involving the pathologist, you're more likely to reach the correct diagnosis. So this is my small number of cases on ILD, and thank you very much for a patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Nazia Madam and CCI team, Dr. Krishna Sir, Dr. Vijay Kumar Sir, Dr. Ravi Dosi, and technical support team for providing me an opportunity to speak among the two icons of Indian lung pathology, Dr. Ranjana Chakravarti Madam and Dr. Chandralekha Thampi Madam. So I am will be discussing the histopathological approach to lung infections. Why I am discussing lung infections? Because it creates a great burden to our society. Acute and chronic pulmonary infections are more frequent infections than any other organ and account for the largest number of workdays lost in general population. These are common in all age group and are a frequent cause of death also. So lung infections can be divided into granulomatous and non-granulomatous infections, and granulomatous further divided into tubercular and non-tubercular. So non-granulomatous infections can be community acquired acute pneumonia, means they are usually viral or bacterial. Then community acquired atypical pneumonia, atypical in the sense they will produce the sputum in a moderate amount, and there is no consolidation, mild increase in WBC count. Now the hospital acquired infections in the long stay of hospital due to severe immunocompromised patients and some invasive device patients on invasive device, then some aspiration pneumonias. These are most dreadful conditions and have a very fulminant course. Then the lung abscess are characterized by the suppurative necrosis surrounded by the neutrophilic abscesses with cavity formation in the center. Now, what is a granuloma? So a granuloma is a compact aggregate of histiocytes, macrophages. The histiocytes in the granulomas are often described as epithelioid. So epithelioid cells are nothing but the activated histiocytes only. Epithelioid means epithelial-like cells, and they have a slipper-shaped nucleus. So aggregation of histiocyte is the minimum requirement of a granuloma, regardless of whether the lesion also contains necrosis, lymphocytes, plasma cells, or multinucleated giant cells. Now the differential diagnosis of granuloma is mycobacterium, maybe fungal, parasites, or sarcoidosis. So our first step towards the approach of granulomas is to identify the organism. It may be by spatial stain or maybe some by PCR technique. Then the second step is to identify correctly the histomorphological findings, and in the form of some necrosis, necrotizing granulomas or non-necrotizing granulomas, what is the location and what is the presentation. Then the third step, if we could not find any organism or we not succeeded to reach a diagnosis, then we put these special stains, some extra blocks. And if after these all exhaustive exercise, if we could not find the correct diagnosis, it is no harm to suggest a differential diagnosis. Now, pulmonary tuberculosis, I will discuss it in detail because it's create a great burden. And tuberculosis continues to remain one of the most pressing health problems in India. India is the highest TB burden country in the world, accounting for 1/5 of the global incidence, with an estimated 1.96 million cases annually. Now, criteria for acceptance of a case of tuberculosis as a pathology is our demonstration of acid fast bacilli on ZN stain or fluorescent microscopy or by PCR. Then presence of necrotizing granulomas inflammation. In absence of caseous necrosis or failure to demonstrate acid fast bacilli, the past history is significant with response to treatment with ATT. Now, in the last, we exclude the other causes of granulomatous inflammation. Now, there are various histological pattern on gross examination. So it may be in the form of tubercular consolidation and mimic as bronchopneumonia, then miliary tuberculosis, fibrocaseous tuberculosis, there will be cavity formation, and It can mimic the lung abscess also, then caseating tuberculosis, and then tubercular empyema when the pus in the pleural cavity, tubercular bronchiectasis, pleural thickening due to pleurisy or pleuritis, then the isolated hilar or mediastinal lymphadenopathy. So in this picture, you can appreciate this is the classical presentation of pulmonary tuberculosis with Ghosn complex. So this is the Ghosn's focus, which is situated on the periphery, and this is the hilar lymph node. Now in this picture, you can appreciate the cavity formation lined by this granulomatous tissue. Now in this picture, you can appreciate these millet seed size tubercles in the diffusely scattered in the lung parenchyma. So this is the miliary presentation. Now the histopathological hallmark is the Mycobacterium tuberculosis is necrotizing granulomatous inflammation. It is composed of epithelioid histiocytes surrounded a central necrotic zone, and it can be accompanied by variable number of multinucleated giant cells and lymphocytes. So in this picture, you can appreciate this is the normal lung with the alveoli spaces with some inflammatory cells. And this is these are the well-formed granulomas. You can appreciate this center caseating necrosis, some giant cells, and the peripheral cuffing by lymphocytes. This is another picture showing the well-formed granulomas with the Langhans type of giant cells. Now there are the various histopathological patterns you can get on microscopy. They may be necrotizing granulomas, non-caseating granulomas, caseating necrosis with Langhans type of giant cells, and sometimes only caseous necrosis. So you would appreciate here, this is the caseous necrosis or ropey necrosis, and appear like the eosinophilic granular debris. In this picture, this necrosis is further advanced by this pathological dystrophic calcification. And there are a lot of giant cells also. Then this is the classic Langhans type of giant cells. It is a multinucleated giant cells, and these nucleus are arranged peripherally. And these are classic epithelioid cells, which are epithelioid histiocytes and having slipper shaped nucleus. So these are the classical findings of Mycobacterium tuberculosis on the histopathology. Now, what is the role of ZN stain in the diagnosis? So first, you have to see under oil immersion under the microscope, and they appear bright magenta or red rods with beaded appearance. Background may be blue, yellow, or green. And thus, what is the sensitivity of ZN stain? It is 60% sensitivity in direct smears. It means that at least 10,000 bacteria should be present per ml for the demonstration in direct smear. And it is quite time consuming. So negative report should not till then, at least you have to identify 100 fields for 10 minutes. So now this is the photomicrograph of bowel fluid showing these beautiful acid fast bacilli on ZN stain. This is the histopathology showing these bright red rods with beaded appearance. Another stain you can apply is fluorescent stain as a oramine-rhodamine stain. It is the sensitivity is high as compared to ZN, but there are a lot of chances of false positivity. Now, why we have to correctly identify the tuberculosis? Because tuberculosis is a great mimic, and it can masquerading as tuberculoma, as a carcinoma, especially in the brain, and the fungal balls as aspergilloma, then as lymphoma and abscesses. So we have to correctly diagnose tuberculosis for the proper treatment, and because it is a completely treatable condition, so we have to correctly identify the tuberculosis. Now I am after the discussion on tuberculosis, I am presenting some interesting cases. So this is the case one, a 33 years old female presented with shortness of breath on exertion already taken treatment for asthma but could not get any relief. CT scan revealed diffuse central lobular micronodular pattern without focal consolidation. And this is the photomicrograph under low power showing these alveolar spaces are filled with these histiocytes. And you can appreciate here, these histiocytes are filled with some organism. On high power view, you can see these are the histiocytes and this is filled with these oval bodies. This is again the high power view and this in the oil immersion, this is one histiocyte containing these oval bodies. These are oval bodies with these perivacuole and these crescent bodies. So histoplasmosis is also called as Darling disease because it is first it was first described by the Samuel Darling. And why is the name called histoplasmosis? Because histo means histiocyte inside the histiocytes and plasmosis means plasmodium. So this was the case of histoplasmosis. Now the second interesting case of a 13-year-old boy presented with cough, hemoptysis and low grade fever of 1 month duration. Chest x-ray showing the opaque shadow in the lower lobe of right lung and CT is the solitary pulmonary mass and with cavitation suggesting of the hydated cyst. Now the patient underwent resection of lower lobe of right lung and this photograph you can appreciate this acellular cyst wall, ectocyst mainly with these fungal colonies. On high power view, this is a photomicrograph showing the acellular laminated hyaline material. This is the photograph showing the beautiful fungal colonies. So the colonies of aspergilloma, aspergillosis are these acute angle branching fungal hyphae and these spores. On the pars stain, you can also appreciate these colonies with acute angle means 45 degree angle branching with these spores. So this was the case of hydrated cyst coexisting with aspergillosis. Now the talk on COVID infection, talk on lung infection cannot be completed by this COVID case. So this was the suicidal case of young adults with the presentation of COVID. And because this is a suicidal case, so medico-legal autopsy was performed under all COVID protocols. So this case, this is the photo micrograph of the lung findings. So you can appreciate here, this is the thrombus in the segmental blood vessels. And the findings in COVID pneumonia, you can get these diffuse alveolar damage, these interstitial hemorrhages and the edema. Then in this picture, you can appreciate this hyaline membrane in the alveolar lining. And the characteristic finding of COVID pneumonia is the type 2 pneumocytes hyperplasia. So as usual in a normal lung, the type 1 pneumocytes are more as compared to type 2. But in COVID case, there is type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia and you can recognize them as swollen cells with some nucleomegaly and prominent nucleoli. So this was the case of COVID case. And because in COVID time or post-COVID, we have get lot of exposure these mucormycosis cases. So this was the picture of mucormycosis. You can see these are broad aseptic fungal hyphae and these are some spores. So this is the picture on pars stain. These are broad aseptic fungal hyphae on mucormycosis. So because in our lung biopsies and in autopsy, we have got lot of chance to get these granulomas. So now I'm concluding my slides or my presentation with the how we narrow down our differential diagnosis. So what is first, we have to recognize what is the state of necrosis. are these are granulomas are necrotizing or not necrotizing, and if necrosis is present, it is of blue necrosis or pink necrosis, because pink necrosis is more in the favor of infections and blue necrosis is more in the favor of the vasculitis. Then the granulomas are well formed or poorly formed, because well formed granulomas are more in the immunocompetent patients and poorly formed in the immunocompromised patients. Then what is the distribution? Is it lymphatic or is it bronchiolar or peribronchiolar or around the vasculature? Then what are the status of spatial stains for these microorganism on spatial fungal stains? Then what is the chances in polarized, what are the polarized light microscopy? So on polarized light, we can appreciate the aspirated material. Now what is the clinical history, or in the end we have to correlate clinical and with the radiological finding. So this is all from my sides, and now I would like to thank our pulmonology colleagues to keep safe our lungs in this COVID area and in future also. And now I hand over podium to the our Dr. Nazia Madam. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ranjini, Dr. Chandralekha, and Dr. Shilpi. It was very knowledgeable and very crisp presentation of all the topics of EBUS, ILDs, and infectious diseases. Now, I want to go on about the discussion. We have certain interesting points what we want to take clinically from the eminent pathologist here. Can I start my discussion? Yeah. I would like to put this question as we started with Dr. Ranjini. Can you please take this question? What are the adequacy criteria for EBUS ROSE, Dr. Ranjini? Can you please?
Thank you, Dr. Nazia. The session was really well conducted. And back to your question, there are several criteria for adequacy in EBUS ROSE, one of which suggests that you need 40 lymphocytes in a high power field to call the smear adequate or the specimen adequate. Another system suggests that you need at least 5 fields, low power fields with 100 lymphocytes for an adequate smear. Clinically, Choi et al. Have suggested that you either need pigmented macrophages or 5 into 100 lymphocytes, or malignant cells to call it, or 2 centimeter core to call it adequate. So adequacy criteria vary according to the system that you use.
Fine, Dr. Ranjini, thank you. I would like to put a question to Dr. Chandralekha, Madam. How diagnostic is microscopy in bowel fluid in the diagnosis of pulmonary alveolar proteinosis? This is an important question we want to know. And what special stains help in this staining of pulmonary alveolar proteinosis? Dr. Chandralekha. Madam, you are, yes.
You can hear me?
Yes, okay. Now.
So in pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, it is, you know, the gross appearance and the amount of fluid, that milky white, you know, yes, that is really very important.
Yes.
You know, that is more supportive of the diagnosis than actually seeing what is under the microscope. Because under the microscope, you would just get maybe a few macrophages and amorphous background. Now, some people say do a pastein. But that pastein is not for a bowel fluid. That pastein has to be done on a biopsy, because in every bowel fluid, there will be some mucin. you know, because the bronchial secretions are mucinous, and anything that's mucinous that has carbohydrate is going to be positive for a pastin. So you say that, oh, I got a bowel fluid, I did a pastin. That's not going to prove that's pulmonary alveolar proteinosis. You need a biopsy that will show you the alveolar spaces, that homogeneous material, that the interstitium are fine, and then a pastin would help you.
Thank you so much, madam. Dr. Shilpi, your presentation on infectious diseases, how will you differentiate between granulomas of tuberculosis and sarcoidosis?
Thank you, Dr. Nazia, for a nice question. As per our Robbins textbook, sarcoidosis and tuberculosis are the two ends of one spectrum. And sometimes it's really very difficult to identify these granulomas as tuberculosis and sarcoidosis on histopathology. As I have discussed, the granulomas of tuberculosis are most of the time caseating type, but sometimes in early stages of tuberculosis and in extrapulmonary tuberculosis, we can find these non-caseating granulomas also. Now, what are the characteristics of sarcoid granulomas? So granulomas of sarcoidosis are called as naked granulomas, because there is lack of lymphoid cuffing. And the granulomas of sarcoidosis are very well formed, discrete, and they are surrounded by a lot of fibrosis. And you can identify this fibrosis by this reticulin stain also. And cavity formation is more common in tuberculosis as compared to sarcoidosis. And if you are fortunate enough, you can recognize these asteroid bodies and Schumann bodies on the biopsy, but really they are difficult to find. And as tuberculosis is very common in India, so you have to think hard to give diagnosis of sarcoidosis, and it is a diagnosis of exclusion.
Yes, doctor, thank you so much. Dr. Ranjani, you have explained about the EBUS ROSE procedure and how you, and can we know how do we define the diagnostic yield in the EBUS ROSE?
Yes, Dr. Nazia. When we say the diagnostic yield, it is the percentage of cases that we are actually able to give a working diagnosis.
Okay.
That is what percentage of cases have a final diagnosis, you know, whether it's an infection, or whether it's malignant. So the diagnostic yield of, like I mentioned in my talk as well,
yes.
Between EBUS TBNA and EBUS TBNA with ROSE are similar, right? In my experience, most of the cases that we have dealt with, many of the cases have been for infection. It's very commonly tuberculosis in our country. And we do back it up with, you know, ancillary testing, right? So when we see maybe macrophages, or we see some ill-defined granulomas, we routinely ask for gene expert or for TBPCR, which kind of helps us come up with the final diagnosis.
Okay. Thank you, doctor. Dr. Chandralekha, madam, again, in the pulmonary alveolar proteinosis, as like, you have already explained this question, but I had this question on the list, so I just want to narrate a question. Is PAF stain in bowel fluid of PAF specific for this diagnosis, or will all bowel not be positive for the PAF stain as they contain some amount of mucus which is PAF positive? I think you have anyways covered this question, madam. I will go for the next question. Yeah, madam, Dr. Chandralekha, madam, is your experience, what is the diagnostic yield in EBUS in your experience, Dr. Chandralekha?
See, we were doing a few EBUS, but I have not found the diagnostic yield to be very strong. And whenever I've discussed with the pulmonologist, they have told me that, you know, the angling is different, because you have to, after you've gone into the bronchoscope, you know, it's a right angle needle and, you know, whatever. And it's been a little bit of a challenge to get through that bronchial wall, reach the lymph node that is adjacent to that. So yes, sometimes we have got material, but often we have not also got material. I've always found a CT guided much more, having much more yield. I'm sure there are other centers that have different experiences, but you asked me what was mine. So yes. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
Dr. Nazia, I'm sorry if I may also just add a point. It is very operator dependent, right? We found that when we work with a certain pulmonologist, we get a very good yield. And it's not uniform, right? Some doctors invariably come up with diagnostic material, and with others, we struggle as well. And that's where Rose helps. We have had situations where we literally had dozens of passes. And even at the end of it, you know, there really isn't diagnostic material. The one thing we do suggest is to usually make separate passes for the cell block, right? So even if you don't have material in the initial smears, there is sometimes additional material in the cell block, then which allows you to do maybe IHC or to send off for molecular testing. So that sometimes helps.
Actually, I was willing to ask the same question to you. What do you want to advise for the pulmonologist about the tissue and the specimen sent to you? So you have covered that question, madam. Thank you. Dr. Shilpi, madam, I would like to ask you, what are the limitations of tuberculosis PCR on biopsy, Dr. Shilpi?
Okay, it is a question of debate also. Actually, it does not distinguish correctly the live and the dead organism. And also, it is not. It can also detect the nucleic acid amplification if there is this of a prior infection also. And in lung abscess, you can get the false positive results. And if the bacterial load is low, so there are also high chances of false negativity. And first, I would like to suggest the pulmonologist, you have to send two different samples for the histopathology and for the these PCR techniques.
Yes.
As in our previous studies, it can send that the histopathology sample should be sent in formalin fixation, and these PCR for sample should be sent in normal saline. But now in recent studies, there are some good results we can also appreciate on these formalin fixed samples also. There are two types of these PCR technique, nested PCR and real-time PCR. As this real-time PCR, this detect the, it target the segment of gene for the mycobacteria. And these nested PCR, these target the repetitive genetic sequencing. So according to our journals, it is that the sensitivity of real-time PCR is good as compared to nested PCR, but nested PCR are more give the more specific results. So that's how the sampling is very important, and so you can get the these are the limitations of PCR on biopsy.
Yes, thank you, doctor. Very precisely explained. There is a question coming up in the chat box. I would like to put to madam. Dr. Ranjani, madam. So one doctor from Telangana is asking how much fluid they have to send to give good yield for cytology and cell block, and most of the time they get normal cytology from pleural fluid, it seems. Is the quantity of pleural fluid matters, or is just yield is low in pleural fluid? Can you please take it, Dr. Ranjani?
Yes, please. Hello, Dr. Hussain. To answer your question, yes, it does help to have a better volume. I would say at least 15 to 20 ml is the minimum. And if you can actually tap more, we usually get about 40, 50 ml at least, I think. More than just the quantity. We certainly require a minimum quantity. It's more important to get your cell block technique right. So it's very important that they centrifuge it for an appropriate interval. And then in my lab, it does fall off. Sometimes there's so much material in the smears, but there really isn't enough in the cell block. So what I always tell them is to, once they have cytocentrifuged it, to use the button first for the cell block and then only the remainder of the material for the smears. Because when the material is in the cell block, we're able to fix it. We're able to do IHC. We're also able to send for molecular testing. So in my view, the cell block is far more valuable than the smears. So it's as much about the technique that they use to make the cell block as the quantity of fluid, saying which we do require a minimum volume. I would think at least 30 ml would be optimal.
Thank you, madam.
Can I say something?
Yes, yes.
Sure. So the policy that we follow in my hospital is that send us all the fluid that you have collected.
Okay.
Because
if it has to be thrown off, let us throw it off, right? So don't throw it off in the ward. So they send us 1 liter, 2 liters, whatever. And then we keep it for 24 hours, we keep it still, because then it sediments. Then we pour off the supernatant and we start working only with what has sedimented. And some we get 8 blocks, 9 blocks, so many cell blocks, because sometimes patients want to do molecular testing, they want to do so many things. And we find that we get a very good cell block yield when we do this. So we tell them, send us all your fluid, all the fluid you've collected. There's no need to throw anything away. Let us throw it.
Yeah, that's a very, very good point taken, madam. We will try to start doing this one in our hospital laboratories. And we'll also talk to the pathologists whom we are here connected with, that we'll send all the fluid. Actually, it's a very good idea to send all the fluid, because every fluid will help in diagnosis. Thank you, madam. Now, the same Dr. Chandralekha, madam, I would like to give this question. If the clinician is willing to go in again for EBUS aspiration, if the Roche shows non-diagnostic or poor cellularity, so they should go for any repeat EBUS, or is the material not lost during the Roche procedure? Can you please throw light on this question?
We were doing Roche quite a bit some time back. But what happened is that we found, Dr. Ranjini will of course tell us more, but very often the clinician did not find it safe enough to go back in again. And then when you do that rapid on-site cytology, these are smears are not, you know, fixed for a very long time. And you cannot test all the smears that have been made. You can only test part of the material that has been aspirated. So you may get a positive. You may say it is enough or it is not. You may also lose some of the cells because of your rapid, quick way that you have fixed it. A little bit of cells may be lost. And very often the clinicians were not willing sometimes to, you know, go in again because there was bleeding or there was something or the other. So it does help you when, you know, you want to tell them it's diagnosed, it's cancer or something like that, or, you know, and they get a quick diagnosis. But it's like Dr. Ranjini also said in her studies, you know, yes, doing with and without Roche, it didn't show too much difference. Because the clinician has to be willing to go in again. He has to be able to go in again. He may be willing, but is the patient in a state to go in again? You know, that I think that becomes a criteria.
Dr. Ranjini, can you please throw your vision and your opinion on this question? It's like the same question, that if the clinician is willing to go for an EBUS after the Roche procedure, do you think the material is lost during the Roche procedure, Dr. Ranjini?
Usually people don't repeat the procedure. It is very expensive, and like madam just pointed out, yes, there are complications. It's an expense as well. So you know, maybe in all these years we've had a couple of patients having repeat EBUS procedures, but it's not a very common occurrence. Don't really think material is lost. In fact, we do a lot of our cytology reporting as Roche. We have a regular head and neck clinic, right? So we have a very good oncosurgeon who does all our thyroid FNAs. So we report that as Roche as well. So we are used to it. In fact, my team does a very good rapid HND and we are so used to it. So we don't really lose material. I don't think that has been an issue. Saying which, again, I'd like to reiterate the point that it's very operator dependent, right? You know, if you have an operator, a pulmonologist or a surgeon, who is anyway going to give you very good yields with FNA, that's going to be the case whether, you know, it's EBUS TBNA or if it is with or without Roche. So that's the key here, I think, that the person who's actually doing the FNA needs to have his skills right.
Sorry to interrupt, ma'am. Dr. Ranjini, ma'am. Yes. Sometimes we get these clots also in the needle streaks. There are some clots. So we have to process these clots also.
Yeah. We usually process them like a cell block, right? We pick them out, we put them in formalin, and then we process them like tissue if we find any clots.
Dr. Shilpi, madam, there's a question from Maharashtra, Pune. Dr. Shashikant is asking, in the histopathology in perspective of COVID pneumonia, and have you come up, I had this question on the mind, in COVID pneumonias, have you done any histopathologies and any special findings you want to tell here in COVID pneumonias, which are different from other
previous? Yes, ma'am. We have get this one autopsy of this suicidal case.
Yes.
So these are the findings in COVID, like diffuse alveolar damage and edema. These are the characteristic finding. We can't say these are residual because these are also found in some drowning cases or some foreign all respiratory asphyxia cases also. But these type 2 hyperplasia, type 2 pneumocyte hyperplasia was the characteristic finding in the COVID pneumonia. And these hyaline membrane change and type 2 hyperplasia, these are the characteristic finding which suggest this COVID case.
Yes, ma'am. There's a question in the chat box. Actually, Dr. Ravi Dosi from Madhya Pradesh is asking, can you please take up Dr. Anjani, madam? Is there any difference in between EBUS sampling from esophagus and the bronchus?
Do you mean transesophageal yes. ultrasound guided?
Yes.
No, not really. In fact, I think very good yields because most of these samples have been coming from gastroenterologists. We routinely get this. We don't always do ROAS with these, but very good yields. And, you know, very often it's tuberculosis.
Okay.
I would say a significant chunk of our cases are TB. I don't think it's very often that we get an EBUS sample for a malignancy or, you know, from a malignant lymph node.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much for the question. Dr. Chandralekha, madam, this question actually, what are the diagnostic differences in the cryobiopsy, bronchoscopic biopsy and VATS biopsy? And can you choose which one to do in particular clinical scenarios? Can you help us how to choose?
A transbronchial biopsy, that is when you're trying to sample the lung, not the bronchus. Otherwise, you'll be doing a bronchial biopsy. Transbronchial biopsy, you're trying to sample alveolar or interstitial parenchymal pathologies. So in that, when you are suspecting a disease that is, you know, peribronchular, because your needle is going to be sampling all the peribronchular things. So if you're thinking of things like sarcoidosis, lymphangitis, carcinomatosis, hypersensitive pneumonitis, then yes, this is a good biopsy. It's easy and, you know, fairly simple to do. But if you're thinking of the other ILDs, like, you know, a UIP, you have doubts about an NSIP or all these, then you really need to see the character, what has happened to that lobule as a whole. You need to see the periphery. You want to know what is in the subpleural area. There you do need a VATS biopsy. Now, a cryobiopsy is, again, going through the bronchus. You're going, you know, as far as you can go. And you are freezing a large chunk, but it is, again, peribronchular. Agreed, the pieces are much bigger than what you get in your routine transbronchial biopsy, but the area of sampling is still the same. It's transbronchial. You're not going to get a whole lobule out, you know? So it's okay if you want to, you know, get a good yield to see all the transbronchial pathologies. And in addition to that, what happens is that there's a little bit of freezing artifact, a little bit. That collagen bits, a little pinker, character changes a little bit in a cryobiopsy as compared to a fresh biopsy. And that is going to, I know it's going to be a little suboptimal when you look at the collagen. So it depends on what you're suspecting most clinically and you decide what biopsy you want to do. You have to have a clinical shortlist and then decide that I can get away with a transbronchial or a cryobiopsy or a needle VATS.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, madam. Dr. Shilpi, madam, can you please take this question? If biopsy is completely necrotic, then what is to be done after that? Then how do we go about the pathology of the lesion?
Okay, ma'am. That's an interesting question. Actually, first, our pulmonology colleagues are what your pathologist mean to say. He is not mean to say that that necrotic biopsy is not not your mistake or it is incomplete, because in center there is necrosis and in periphery there is the mass, or in this caseating tuberculosis also some in center there is necrosis, so you are not incomplete and we are not blaming you as you have sent necrosis. So what we can do, so first we have to advise them that you have some radiological assisted biopsy or take some wider chain. And if you are suspecting malignancy, then you should send the samples for histopathology and molecular pathology. And if you are suspecting some infectious disease, then you have to send more samples for the microbiological analysis. And as pathologists, If we get biopsy necrotic, then we can apply, and we have to take some extra efforts to apply these special stains on necrotic tissue, because there are some chances that we can get organism in this necrotic tissue also.
Okay, point well taken, madam. Dr. Ranjini, you have told about the training of manpower and also the passes required. Can you please tell us again about how important is this training of manpower in EBUS roles and also the number of passes required? Dr. Ranjini, madam, I can't see you, madam. Your internet, I think you are not connected. I think yes, some internet issues is there, I think, with Dr. Ranjini. Dr. Chandralekha, madam, I will ask you this question. How often do you give significant diagnostic information in a routine bowel fluid examination?
So I think this is like I think Dr. Hussain asked, like, yes. How often, yes, are you diagnostic in a pleural fluid?
Yes, yes.
So similarly, yes, in a bowel, the positivity rates, I mean, they're not very, very strong. I think bowel, it will be more useful because you're sending it for microbiology and, you know, you can get some growth or something or the other. Getting malignant cells in a bowel fluid, which is why it comes to us histopathologists, or something like that, is not very common. I think when you suspect something like that, you're more likely to do a biopsy. If you've done a biopsy and then the bowel follows that, then you're likely to get some shed malignant cells within that, but they already have the biopsy. Siderophages sometimes can be picked up. Maybe some fungi can be picked up. These are the things that are probably more likely to have a yield. But we can tell you, you know, whether it's looking more inflammatory or whether it's non-inflammatory or that. But other than this, doesn't tell you too much.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. Madam, Dr. Shilpi, madam, I will ask you this question again. Like, we have seen so many cases of post-COVID fibrosis, and you are giving antifibrotics in patients. Have you come across samples for ILDs and any biopsy sample of post-COVID fibrosis patient in your practice and sampling of these things? And did you find any difference between the other things and post-COVID fibrosis?
Not actually yet. We have not these samples for histopathology, because I think most of the time these fibrosis are diagnosed by CT scan. Yes, and CT, yes, scans are quite popular to get these fibrosis on CT scan. So we don't get these biopsies to get fibrosis for root.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Ranjini.
Obviously, we've had a few post-COVID biopsies.
Okay,
and they have shown a little more fibrosis. And it doesn't come to us to look at the fibrosis. It comes to us because, you know, they want us to look whether there's mucor or some other fungus or something. So it comes to us for that, but we do see in the background there is a little more fibrosis. Yeah.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am. This is an important point. Dr. Ranjini, I think we lost you in between.
Yeah. Sorry, my device is...
No problem at all. I had this question for you, madam, about training of manpower. You told in your talk about the training of manpower of EBUS roles and also the number of passes required. Can you please enlighten on this, madam? And how important is this? Like, how do you go about this training of manpower of numbers of passes?
Yeah, a number of passes is the easy question. So yes, the recommendation is at least three passes. And there is literature to show that doing more than three passes for routine diagnosis doesn't really add any benefit. Except, of course, if you want material for ancillary testing, right, then the recommendation is that at least you do four passes. Three passes for the diagnostic material and an additional pass for ancillary testing. In terms of training of manpower, I think it's twofold. One, it's the pulmonologist getting used to the technique of FNA itself, which when to apply suction. If it's a very hemorrhagic sample, to minimize suction so that the blood doesn't ration, what areas to choose and how many passes. So all this would be vital from the perspective of the pulmonologist. And from the pathology perspective, it is very important to know what is adequate. You have to know the clinical history, and you have to avoid pitfalls generally? You know, sometimes my trainees are really taken aback because there are sheets of bronchial cells, and obviously it's a transbronchial aspirate. So you could get sheets of reactive bronchial cells. And looking for the adequate number of lymphocytes. So this is the training in terms of the pathologists, and in terms of training the technicians, it's having them do the stains appropriately. It's probably choosing what you are comfortable with as well. So like I said, my team is very good at rapid HND because, you know, we do a lot of rows anyway. So, and I'm kind of used to reporting on HND. So I prefer that. So it's training your technical team to come up with the optimal protocols as well.
Thank you so much, madam. Dr. Chandralekha, madam, I missed to ask you about this one. How do we compare, like how do you compare CT-guided lung biopsy and transbronchial biopsy for diagnosis yield in non-malignant cases?
This was something that, you know, I have often wondered, because transbronchial lung biopsy doesn't give you that much lung tissue, you know, because you're going through the bronchus, and at least 50% of it is going to be bronchial wall and bronchial lining and exfoliated strips and all that. But when you do a CT-guided biopsy, you're right in the lung parenchyma. So I've often asked my pulmonologist that why don't we just do a CT-guided biopsy, you know, and not the transbronchial.
CT-guided biopsy is definitely better.
Yeah, but I believe the problem is that it's very difficult to get a biopsy in a lung that is not solid or a mass.
You know, yeah, we have certain complications. Yes, we are afraid of complications which can happen when we are doing a lung.
But I've always seen that there's more alveolar tissue, there's much more to comment upon, much more to evaluate in a CT-guided biopsy.
Yes, ma'am, very well taken. Thank you, madam. Madam, I would put this question to all of you. Like I would ask about how do you advise, like what message you want to give the pulmonologist regarding the sending of specimens? Like we have asking about pleural fluid and how much tissue is required and which biopsy and which method is required. Can you please, each of you, can you give a certain point so that we'll make a note of it when we are sending samples to you for the histopathological examination? Both in infectious as well as in connective tissue or IRE diseases. Can you please ask, start Dr. Ranjini, your...
Yes, I guess close communication with your pathology team would be the key. It would, I guess, it, and that has to be two-way as well. We have to tell you what we need and what we think is adequate. And I think if we work closely as a team, I'm sure, you know, we would get better samples.
Yeah, Dr. Chandralekha, madam, anything?
Okay, I think that it would start with first, even before you do the biopsy, you first tell what is your problem, you know, to the pathologist that, you know, this is what I'm suspecting. And, you know, what would be the best way to get tissue for this? So then, you know, whether it's going to be a transbronchial CT guided, whether it's going to be FNA or a node or whatever it is, you know, you want to sample. And secondly, this discussion also has to be ongoing. So when you get the sample, also the pathologist has so many differentials in, you know, in her head. And then if you can talk and say, you know, this is what I'm seeing, this is what I'm seeing. And well, what are you thinking? What was the serology? What was this? And if you keep getting this continuing input, you're more likely to reach a more appropriate diagnosis. So the conversation has to be continuous. And also, if you're thinking of malignancy, then you have to tell the pathologist upfront, you know, that I hope the tissue is enough, that I will need to do molecular tests, I will need to do other things. And similarly, when the pathologist, if she's done a frozen on it or even an EBUS, and she sees it's infective, then right away she has to say, I'm going to send part of this fresh tissue to the microbiologist, you know? So the talk has to be continuous. There has to be a very good degree of comfort between the clinician and the pathologist. And each one has to know the limitations of the other.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. That was very well taken. Dr. Shilpi, can you please
Our madam have had very good. But in our college, we give our pulmonologist the picric acid. And because these picric acid stain these material, so it is easy to identify these material. And for pulmonologist, I suggest you take more and more pieces. If pieces are more, you can take 8 to 10 pieces. Or if pieces are more, there are high chances to get the sample. And in actually blood clots or in clotted sample, if you get, these are very less chances to get the proper sample and proper viable cells. So this is hard to diagnose. So picric acid, we must suggest.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. This is important about picric acid. We'll remember this one. And madam has told about this, there should be a collaboration and association between the clinician and the pathologist, and I would also say the radiologist. So this is an important point that we should note, that the diagnosis is something like a detective's process, and we need all the clues to get the diagnosis. So the clinico-pathological and radiological correlation. So I think every hospital or most of the doctors who are in practice should have a team, and they should, for each and every case, they should be able to discuss about the diagnosis and also follow up. Madam, I want to ask, any one of you can take this question. Do you get follow-up samples for any diseases? Like if you have diagnosed a certain ILDs or UIPs, then do you feel like you should see a follow-up of the case after getting the diagnosis, after treatment, and what was the pathology changes you have seen? Dr. Shilpi, can you please take this question?
Yes, ma'am. In tuberculosis, we can take the sample as bacterial load is low. Yes. As compared to the previous, and in some leprosy cases also, in dermatology, we can resolved leprosy cases, and what is the status of this bacterial index. So this can we see?
Madam? Yeah, fine. Yes, ma'am, that definitely we will see the decrease in the number of bacterial load and
bacterial
all.
Load.
Yes, and one more question I had in my mind, madam, when you are diagnosing on histopathology, so many malignancies and ILDs and granulomas and sarcoidosis. So do you get samples from other tissues as well? Like, for example, if you are diagnosing connective tissue disease, like madam has told about SLE or sometimes sarcoidosis, do you like to have samples from the other tissues sometimes, like a skin biopsy or anywhere else? Do you get such specimens both from other tissues, lung as well as skin or something? Anybody, ma'am? Dr. Chandralekha, madam, if you have seen such cases.
So usually, we say that this is likely to be SLE from maybe primarily presenting in the lung, and then they go back. Then I think usually the blood test will tell you if the kidney is involved or other things, and then the clinician decides whether she wants anything more.
Okay.
But we don't ask.
Okay, fine. Thank you, ma'am. We have one question in the chat box. I would like to see this question. Dr. Abdullah Saleem from Telangana wants to ask, how do you differentiate HPE from the patient with tuberculosis and sarcoidosis? Actually, even I had this on the list. This madam has covered, Dr. Shilpi madam has covered. Can you please tell him again, ma'am? How tuberculosis and sarcoidosis?
The tuberculosis granulomas are caseating granulomas most of the time. And in sarcoidosis, these are non-caseating type. And if you get necrosis in sarcoidosis, it is not of caseating type. It is of fibrinous type or coagulative type. And granulomas of sarcoid are well-formed, discrete, and surrounded by fibrosis. And they are called as naked granulomas because there is loss of lymphoid cuffing.
Thank you, madam. Very well taken. Dr. Ranjani, madam, this one thing, can you tell me as the importance of EBUS rows in ancillary testing, the role in ancillary testing of EBUS rows?
Yes, obviously, you know, with lung cancers, the important thing now is to save tissue for ancillary testing.
Yes.
And which is where the cell block is important. I don't know if many centers actually were able to do tests on smears, at least in India. Obviously, the yield is much better if it is a cell block. So as long as we get adequate material within the cell block, we are able to do ancillary testing. And very often we find there is actually more material in the cell block than in the biopsy. The biopsy tends to be small, and usually the cytology sample is adequate, whether it's an FNA or a pleural fluid. There is usually adequate material for molecular testing if it's a pulmonary malignancy, or for TVPCR, or even for some other kind of PCR.
Thank you, madam. It was a very great discussion with all the eminent pathologists all over the India, from Mumbai, Hyderabad, and from Indore. Thank you, ma'ams. And we had 1,008 logins in this webinar. So it was a big thing, actually. Thank you so much for all the people who have participated in the seminar. And I would also like to say that we are going to come up with many more webinars which will cover pathology topics which are important, like malignancies and other pleural disorders, pleural malignancies, and on any molecular markers which usually we want to learn more about this, which have IHC marking and all. We will come about in Chest Council of India. We'll start this webinars. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to personally thank all the doctors, Dr. Shilpi, Dr. Ranjani, and Dr. Chandralekha, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Nazia. It was very well conducted. And I would also like to congratulate my co-speakers. Really enjoyed both their sessions. So it was a pleasure touching base with all of you. And here's to many more sessions like this. Thank you and good night, everybody.
And Dr. I would also like to thank the CCI members, Dr. Chinnam Shetty Vijay Kumar sir and Dr. Ravi Dosai sir, Narendra sir, for giving me this opportunity to moderate this session. It was a great learning experience, madam. Thank you.